लगा बोला भारत माता के जय बोलो, जय श्री राम बोलो, सुअर का मीट खिलाओ।
कितना का
पहले भारत माता की जय बोल।
The internet is littered with videos of people, mostly men, shouting, coercing or simply asking people to either sing Vande Mataram or chant Bharat Mata Ki Jai. The question really is, why? What does memorizing Vande Mataram and chanting Bharat Mata Ki Jai signify, and where does the question itself come from? I think to understand this phenomena, we need to look at three things. 1. The idea of a nation. 2. India and its history with nationalism. And 3. The identity of being Indian today. I think a good starting point to exploring the idea of the nation can be from the works of Benedict Anderson, the world-renowned political scientist, who in 1983 published his book Imagined Communities, in which he explored the origins of nationalism. It must be noted that he bases his arguments primarily in the European context, and we can later explore its effect on our own history. Anderson defined a nation as an imagined political community, and imagined as both inherently limited and sovereign. There are four key words in that definition that he elaborates upon. He describes it as imagined, as every member of the nation would never know every other member, interact with them, or even come across them, but they still feel a kinship to them, which he describes as imaginary. He explains his use of limited as that every nation can only exist if other nations exist outside them. In other words, all nations have boundaries, even if they can be changing at times. No nation thinks that all of humanity exists within it. He explains his use of sovereign as the idea of the nation came with the age of enlightenment and revolution, where people were realizing that the claims of kings and rulers as being men of God was false. Hence he says, inherently the idea of the nation is synonymous with an idea of the freedom of the individual. This can then be further seen as democracy and the empowerment of the citizen as a basic building block of the nation. And finally, the nation is imagined as a community because regardless of any inequality or exploitation within it, it is always imagined that everyone in the nation shares a camaraderie or a sense of brotherhood within it. Anderson also proposes that one of the key factors behind the propagation and popularity of the idea of the nation came through the invention and popularity of the printing press and through what he calls print capitalism. Initially, when printing as a technology had arrived, it was used predominantly to print what people in power wanted to propagate and in the language of the ruling elite. But as time progressed, the publishers realized that a much larger audience and by extension a much larger market existed for the written word if they printed in the vernacular. This met with huge success, both financially for the publishers and had a great impact on human history itself. With relation to nationalism, however, Anderson explains that print capitalism affected it primarily in three ways. Through writing, people who might not have understood each other because of different characteristics of spoken languages, such as pronunciations, accents, dialects, etc., were able to understand each other through the written word. The popularity of books and print also led to uniformity of language. This also made people aware of a community who spoke the same language as them, even though in reality they actually might not have. Again, this imagination is what Anderson describes as the embryo of the imagined community. 2. Print capitalism, in creating uniformity in language, also gave some languages and dialects more political power, especially those which were closer to the print language than others. In India, this is easy to see, as all of us know of languages that are spoken at home but are not available in print. 3. Print capitalism gave a new fixity to language, making it more uniform than it had ever been in history. But this also led to a uniformness in the imagination of language in antiquity. This means that a person in, say, the 15th century had much less access to the words of his ancestors from the 14th century to someone, say, in the 19th century who could read about them. This led to the birth of a more homogenized idea of history and the past in the modern world that had existed in any other period in history. This change in outlook in modern times was very important in the birth of nationalism, as history has an important role to play in the idea of the nation. In 1990, another renowned political scientist, Eric J. Hobsbawm, in his book Nations and Nationalism Since 1780, explained how history is reconstructed in a way to suit the ideology of nationalism and is essential to the construction of the idea. He says that nationalism may begin as an idea within the elites, but its propagation requires the support of the masses. History plays an important role in both creating the basis of this unity and for sustaining it. Hence, history is rewritten or reconstructed to suit the idea of nationalism. The best example of this can be seen in the difference in how the same history is taught through different lenses in India and Pakistan. What is seen as partition is also the defining moment of the birth of a nation. What is right or wrong is an impossible judgment. Both the countries see the same event in time differently, interpret it differently, and teach it differently to the new generations. Now that we have a grasp on the origins of the nation and its relationship with history, we can now explore it in the context of India and take a closer look at Indian history.
एम्बिशन ये थी कि बड़ा
कांटों को मुरझाने का खौफ नहीं होता।